It's a very well-behaved crowd. Where are those nasty women? good morning. I'm Jennifer Raab and have the great privilege of being the president of this extraordinary institution, Hunter College, and to welcome you here on behalf of myself and our Jonathan Fanton, Director of Public Policy Institute at Roosevelt House, to this important discussion of women's leadership. This morning, you'll hear from four extremely impressive and highly successful women as they tell us how they got to where they are and how they overcame the barriers in their way. We are waiting for our extraordinary Lieutenant Governor, who is truly the Energizer Bunny. She is everywhere, and she's caught on a plane this morning from Buffalo, but I was going to tease her that she's here at Hunter so often, we're going to give her the Roosevelt bedroom upstairs. Also, the wonderful, and I think she's on her way down, Rossana Rosado, our Secretary of State, who is truly one of the great women mentors and role models in this city, in this state, in this country, as a journalist, and then, of course, as a public official, and then someone smart enough to send her son to Hunter College. And then you'll hear more in the bios from two wonderfully accomplished and really transformational women who were making a difference, Glennda Testone from the LGBT Community Center, one of the great public spaces in our city, and Christina Halpern, who is taking on the really critical work of trying to get more gender diversity in our world of technology. So thank you for that, Christina. There could be no better place than to have this event this morning, because Hunter College was the, there she is. Come on in, Rosanna. I was just talking about your incredible skills as a leader, as a journalist, as a public servant, but even better as a mother, having sent your precious child to Hunter College. So always a little plug. And Hunter College is really, as I said, the best place to have this event today, because Hunter was only the ninth school in the country to accept women into college. And our founder, Thomas Hunter, believed that teachers should have a professional training experience before they turned right back up in front of the classroom. And this was some of the first professional empowerment for women, and it was so ahead of its time in 1870. And he believed that women from all backgrounds, races, and ethnic groups, which again at that time to welcome what, as he called it, one of his great lines, the black should sit next to the Jew who will sit next to the Gentile. I mean, an old-fashioned word, but he believed truly in not discriminating against anybody but men. So that was our founder, and we went on, of course, to become a place of great women's empowerment. We're the only school in the world to have two women Nobel Prize winners in medicine. And if any of you saw the Academy Awards a few weeks ago, there was an extraordinary commercial about what if women scientists were treated as Kim Kardashian. And there was this incredible billboard of a lady with blue hair, and she was Mildred Dresselhaus, known as the Queen of Carbon. And she, of course, was a Hunter High School and Hunter College graduate, has won the National Medal of Honor for Science, and was trained at Hunter College by one of our Nobel Prize winners. So this is a long and powerful tradition of women leaders in every field. And of course, here we are, what better place than Roosevelt House, where Franklin and Eleanor lived before they moved to the White House. And although Eleanor often felt discouraged by the painfully slow and stubbornly unfair march of progress, she really remained perpetually optimistic about women's potential, no matter what the challenge, and said memorably, "Women are like tea bags. You never know how strong they are until you put them in hot water." So it is in this world, this home of Franklin and Eleanor, and in this school that created so much empowerment, that it is a truly pleasure and real emotional pleasure to introduce our moderator, Chika Onyejiukwa. Chika, where are you? There she is. Chika represents the spirit of Hunter College. There's an old saying, you can always tell a Hunter girl, but you can't tell her much. And I found that to be true when Chika was our student body president and I had to meet with her regularly. Chika moved on from being the Hunter College student government president to be the student representative on the CUNY Trustees Board, representing hundreds of thousands of students in this wonderful system of CUNY. She is a rising star. She has much to learn from the women on the panel, whom she will introduce and moderate this discussion. But Chika, at the end of the day, I know that we have much to learn from you, too. You have an extraordinary future. We're very proud, and it is a great pleasure to welcome you and all of you here today for this important discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much. A big round of applause to President Raab for her great work. So now I'll start off by introducing our... Before I start, I want to wish you all a happy Women's History Month, which is what the month of March is. So I will start off by introducing our amazing panel for this afternoon. To my right is the Secretary of State of New York State, Rossana Rosado. The Executive Director of the Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, Transgender Community Center, Glennda Testone. The Founder and Executive Director of All Star Code, Christina Halpern. And last but of course not least, our Lieutenant Governor of New York State and our host for today's panel, who will be joining us shortly, Kathy Hochul. So I'm thrilled to be moderating this panel today with such successful New York women to discuss professional barriers that they have encountered and their unique strategies to overcome them. So I'll start off by giving you a brief overview of our discussion, and then we'll jump right in. So to start, I will start by directing questions at you all, some general, some specific, and feel free to jump in if you feel that it relates to you. And then to transition, we will open it up to the audience to ask questions, and so you should have note cards. And once you're finished writing your question on the note card, if you just pass it to the end of your aisles, someone will collect your note card from you. So we're going to get started with our secretary. So I see that you started your career in media. You transitioned into doing some amazing work in criminal justice. You served as a distinguished lecturer at John Jay College, and you served on the governor's council for prison reentry. I wanted to know, what made you passionate about choosing your field, and how have you seen the field that you've chosen evolve with women over the years?
Okay. Well, thank you, and thank you, President Raab. Because she's my son's Jewish mom, and she just reminded me of that. And it's always great to be here, both at Hunter and here in this building. So I am probably the senior on the panel, so I can say that I've been lucky to have had, I guess, several careers or, you know, kind of several choices in my life. And I think what made me passionate about journalism, where I spent most of, I guess, 30 years, was I just loved the narratives. I always loved telling stories, and I always thought that I could tell them best. And when you're a reporter, especially a newspaper reporter, in the days when that was a revered career, you went out, you interviewed people, you came back, and you put it all together. You know, you kind of digested it for people, and I like that. There was a time when I worked in television. I did television production, and I won an Emmy, and that was fun, but it involved too many people. There's a cameraman, there is, you know, the editor, there is a producer, everybody wants a role, and I like being, you know, a lone ranger in that sense of going out and finding the perspectives on the stories. I was lucky that I got to work as a reporter in the early 80s for the Spanish language newspaper, El Diario, which eventually I would come back to run. And it was also fascinating kind of telling that story from this Latino lens, that, you know, that at the end of the day, the story was important, it was newsworthy, but it also had a major impact on the people that I felt very connected to. So I was really, you know, I was lucky. So, and then to kind of segue to the next thing, I wasn't sure what the next thing was going to be. After about 20 years at El Diario, I knew I wanted to work in criminal justice, and I needed to find a role there, and I went around the city because I was publisher at the time. I was a CEO, and so I called up people, and they said they answered the phone, and they agreed to meet with me. And I said, you know, I'm going to leave El Diario and I really want to pursue kind of a career in criminal justice. And everyone was like, you're crazy. Don't do that. But I did it anyway. And then I went to John Jay because I had to hide from Jennifer and go to John Jay because I wanted to kind of be in the place where people, you know, John Jay is a place where you have students who are going to be law enforcement and both students who are going to be advocates. And the kind of the slogan for the school is fierce advocates for justice. Mm-hmm. But it seems to be the place where everything in criminal justice converge from policy to practitioners. And I thought if I sat there for a while that through osmosis, I would get smarter about it. And I wound up teaching in their prison program. I have been doing that for a while too. And so, but I had the freedom, I want to say that. I had the freedom because of my years in journalism and the relationships that I had, all those years that I had cultivated. I was able to kind of pick my next thing and say, I'm going to put myself out there and tell people what I'm interested in, and then they'll keep me, you know, top of mind. And so the governor called me to chair the council, and that was that's been a wonderful experience. But in his mind, that was his way to reel me in. So that's why here I am. Anyway, so that was smart of him too, right? I worked for 2 years on the reentry council as a volunteer while I was teaching at John Jay, and I worked with Alfonso David, who is the general counsel to the governor. And when I started the process, I was like, I want to make a lot of noise. And he said, do you want to make noise or do you want to get things done? And I said, can we do both? And he said, no, some, you know, in criminal justice, you want to get stuff done so that it's done and it can't be undone. And then you can tell people about it. And so that process of being able to do really important work anonymously, that's what kind of hooked me on coming to government, so that when the governor asked me to come, you know, he doesn't really ask. He just says, this is what you're going to do next. But I was really enthused about doing a lot of important things that don't always get, you know, the front pages. And so that's a perfect segue to welcoming the lieutenant governor.
Oh, God, I think I just...
You know, there was a time when I had the best record in the state of New York for on-time arrivals. You know, that's covering thousands of miles, going around the world about a million times. And so I can't control an hour and a half late plane from Buffalo this morning. So I do apologize. And great to see everybody. And I just have to say thanks to this amazing institution, Madam President. This I think this is my home away from home. You have hosted so many. That's right. Well, the answer is yes. Next time I'm coming in the night before, yes, count on that. But you have been spectacular in opening up this magnificent facility, so steeped in history and important to what we're talking about today. So I'm really delighted to be here back at Hunter. And I know, Chika, good to see you again. Nice. You're graduating senior now? Is that happening?
I am.
She introduced me back in 2015 when we did an event on sexual assault here, too. So it's great to be here, Glennda, and Madam Secretary, and good to get a chance to get to know Christina. So do I have a question before me?
Yes,
okay.
Yes, you do.
Okay. Is the question what got me doing what I'm doing?
Yeah, so I see that back in 2015 when you introduced Enough is Enough, I think here at CUNY we saw your fingerprints on combating sexual assault. You're now chairing the 100th year anniversary of the Women's Suffrage Commission. What made you passionate about going into public service, and how have you seen public office change for women over the years?
I will tell you that I think I'm a product of my upbringing. I grew up in a very conservative part of the state, but I had these crazy liberal parents who took me to all the marches of our day, civil rights, women's rights, back in the late 60s, you know, war demonstrations, the whole nine yards. So I grew up in a very atypical household where my parents were not political whatsoever. They just had a strong social conscience, and I think I adopted that. And I was able to see that, you know, through learning about government in school and participating in some programs in Washington and college, I really thought that government was the vehicle to better people's lives. And I believe we all make a difference in our own way. But that was my path. It's something I was not afraid of. And even though I was the only woman in a room working with Tim Russert in high school, working on campaigns like Senator Moynihan's first race, and I just had something, maybe a screw loose or something, but it kind of pulled me toward government and politics as the way that I would be able to hopefully change people's lives for the better, because at the end of the day, that's what we're all called to do. I mean, that's why I think we're taking up space on this planet, is to leave it a better place. And so as altruistic and idealistic as that may sound, many, many, many years later, I still believe that. I still believe that having been elected at the town, county, federal, and now state level, I still believe there's so much we can do, and the power of government is something the government, I believe, so strongly in to change people's lives. How I've seen it change when I was just a high school kid working on my first campaigns, the first woman running for lieutenant governor, Marianne Krupczak, was on the ballot, and I remember thinking, wow, this is going to be the norm now. We're going to have women run all over, and I was wrong back in 1974. Then in 1984, when I was a staffer, an attorney on the staff of a congressman on Capitol Hill, Geraldine Ferraro waltzed into our office, and she's going to be the first one running for vice president, then president right after. And so I've kind of been in this game for the long haul, and I really thought that it was going to change dramatically this past November, but not the result we wanted, but the result, if there is a good plan B, it is that I believe women are more energized than I've seen in my lifetime. And I'm energized by that as well. So I'm not seeing the numbers I want to see in terms of participation. We're still woefully deficient in number of women in Congress. When I was there, it was 20%. Our state legislature is about 25%, 27%. The city council is 25% here in very progressive New York City, 25% of city council. Chief administrative officers, our mayors, our county executives, places where I think women just shine with our ability to multitask and do 1,000 things at once. 30 years ago, we were at 13%. Today, 13%. So, yeah, I know it's really depressing. But I feel even now more than ever, the climate is right. There are women coming up to me constantly who want to know the secret sauce. I'm training. I'm trying to encourage people. Over 4,000 women nationally have stepped up and want to run for office. So 2016 was supposed to be the year of change. Something did change, and that is complacency is dead. And women know they have to get out, fight, support women candidates, or run. Whatever sources they can bring to the table, we need their voices desperately heard. And I feel even more passionate about that than any time in my life, as I said. So thank you.
Thank you. So, Christine, I'm going to direct the same question back to you. So you, like the secretary, you started out with a career in journalism, and now you're the executive director of All Star Code, which is a fast-growing non-for-profit education organization that prepares young men of color into the tech field. And you've also been Jet Magazine's Top 40 Under 40, The Roots 17 Women in STEM You Should Know. What made you passionate about your career changes, and how have you seen the field that you're in change for women over the years?
Oh, interesting. So how did I end up in this place? Mm-hmm. And then I'll also talk about why my organization, which works with high school youth, works actually with boys and not girls, which is the question I get all the time. Just out of curiosity, how many people here run their own business, have their own business, are entrepreneurs? Okay. And then how many want to start their own business or organization? Oh, interesting. So I was born here in New York City, and I say I'm the daughter of two very successful strivers. My mother was born in a tiny fishing village in the Philippines, but she was a very much sort of, you know, small village girl, but like meant for the big city. You meet her, she's just like, ah. So she made it to Manila, became a lawyer, and then ended up in New York after passing the bar where she met my father. And my father was born black in 1942 in segregated Baltimore, and then over the course of his time had been able to come to New York and work at a white shoe law firm. They met here in the 60s. By the time I came around in 1980, my father's, both my parents were working as lawyers, and I was very much raised in a, you know, kind of like a striver household with a lot of, you know, a lot of expectations, et cetera. I was a very creative child. I went to Dalton, lovely private school here on the Upper East Side. Then my father ended up becoming very successful and went from being a lawyer to a financier and did a series of leveraged buyouts, the last one being of the international division of Beatrice Food Company. that was a large conglomerate that was based all over the world. And when I was 8, we ended up moving to Paris, where he ran this big business, about 30 food brands all over Europe, some in Asia. And I had this strange life where, again, my parents were both born pretty poor in different ways. We're now in Paris, and I sometimes toured factories with my father. But unfortunately, when I was 12, he got sick and he died of a brain tumor. And we moved very suddenly back to New York. There was a lot of turmoil. Long story short, it was a very sudden experience for me, and it showed me, and I became very conservative, actually. And I was always a very creative child. I became very conservative, and for the next 15 years was basically like, if there was a ladder, I was going to climb up it. I did get good grades. I went to Harvard and was desperate for a career and settled on journalism because it was the only sort of ladder career I could find that was still kind of creative because I loved new ideas. I loved talking to people. And in retrospect, I see that I was very much a natural entrepreneur. A classic entrepreneur. Entrepreneurs always have lots of ideas, they're not super focused, but I was fitting myself into this ladder box because, I had some issues. Several years ago, as I'd reached a certain age, journalism was changing. I was at the Wall Street Journal, Murdoch had bought it, a lot was going on, and I kind of came to this realization that I'd been in this box. Yeah, and this is something that I think a lot of people can relate to. Women can relate to it a lot. Imposter syndrome. But I feel that people of color, men and women, can also relate to this as well. People from rural areas who come to the city relate to it. It's really a broader thing that we feel that the way people see us or that what we have to do, what's expected of us, isn't really who we are. But you can see from my background of my parents, economic mobility, socioeconomic change is economic equality is something that I was really always raised with, and both my parents were very, were very aware of the world and showed me lots of things. And just to place this, I decided to leave the journal and had a little bit of an eat, pray, love year, in which time I wrote a memoir, and this memoir was actually about my father and ask the question, how did he become so successful? And in this book, I really researched a summer program that he went to that was actually at Harvard Law School. It was that actually recruited black students who were at the black colleges at the time in 1960s to actually come and learn about the law. Again, the higher education system was largely segregated. This was the first time this was done. And that is how my father gained entree into sort of the all-white world of corporate law at that time, and President Jennifer had spoken about, you'd mentioned the blacks, the Jews next to the blacks, the next to the Gentiles. It does happen that the professors who created this program at Harvard Law School were the Jewish professors at the law school who had only themselves been admitted, 10 to 15 years earlier. In any case, when I learned this and saw how my father had benefited from this opening of access, I had this idea that maybe there was room for this again today, but not on Wall Street, but in tech, which is a field which is incredibly undiverse from a gender perspective as well as a racial perspective. About 10% of engineering departments at a large technology company are female. Roughly 5%, 4 to 5% are black or Latino, male and female. And in the startup space, say among VC-backed startups, the numbers are even worse. So that thinking about that is what brought me on this journey. Supposed to fast forward 6 years later, Allstart Code now has 12 people. We are the largest organization focused on, again, high school boys in this learn to code space. Reshma Saljani from Girls Who Code is on our advisory board. And to answer the question of why girls, not boys, the thing is, this is a real challenge. What? I'm sorry, why boys, not girls? Saw that this group is neglected, particularly in the K-12 space. They do face unique challenges, and the same kinds of solutions, wonderful solutions that are being created for girls from an end-to-end perspective, I saw that there wasn't someone focused on doing it, for boys, again, in high school. That is where the intervention of our program is. In the actual career space and in the job market, the intersectionality is very important. Sexism in the actual tech industry itself is a real, real problem. However, we're about growing the pipeline. So I think that question. I can talk about sort of as a woman, or we can come back
to
that.
We'll come back to that. Thank you. So Glennda, I'll briefly pose the same question to you. The Lieutenant Governor spoke about us serving as vehicles to better people's lives, and so I've seen that you've been a champion of the LGBT community for a very long time, and so you currently serve as the Executive Director of New York City's Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, and Transgender Community Center. Can you speak a little bit about what made you go into choosing this career and how you've seen this field evolve for women leaders over the years?
Sure. So thank you for having me, and especially thank you to the Lieutenant Governor, to President Raab, and so excited to be on the panel with Christina and Rossana. I am going to condense and say that I think our parents would have been friends at the time. I'm originally from upstate New York, Syracuse, and my dad was an educator and retired as an administrator in upstate New York. And my mother was a social worker, and she spent 35 years of her career at an African American community center in Syracuse that served the African American community. So they were both sort of very much wanted to help people and encouraged me a lot. I went to Syracuse University and got a degree in broadcast journalism, which I promptly did not use. And I went on to get a master's degree in women's studies because I really wanted to change the world. And I became an activist, essentially. And I wanted to sort of learn more about what's wrong with the world, how can we change it. From there, I got my first job at GLAAD, which was the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation. And it was a media organization trying to get more fair and accurate representation of LGBT people in the media. I went to another media-related job at the Women's Media Center, founded by Gloria Steinem and Jane Fonda, and at that organization, we were really trying to get progressive women's voices into the media. So we had a training program and database, and we pitched women. And at that time, this was right around 2008, 2009, something happened to the economy in our country, and I really saw a lot of the people that I knew struggling to make ends meet. And I also started dating my partner, who was a social worker. So my mom was a social worker, but I think there's something even closer when you're partnered with a social worker. And she was working with LGBT homeless youth here in the city. And I could literally see the difference she was making in people's lives. And so I became a little disillusioned with the media and thought, you know, this is really important and I still believe in it, but I would like to try making a change that's a little more tangible, that I can feel, that I can see, that's in my community. And the job at the LGBT Center opened up. I have been there for 7.5 years. I'm the first female executive director at the center. We were founded in 1983. And I feel similar to Kathy. It is just such an exciting time, I think, for the LGBT community. There was a way in which some people, I would say, especially more privileged people in the LGBT community, we're becoming complacent, we're taking a step back, we're thinking, you know, we've achieved a lot. We live in New York City, we live in New York State, even federally, you know, we've got a president who supports us. That's gone. I think people, there are no sidelines anymore. I see people engaged, men and women, in a myriad of different ways, and it's really, after the results of the federal election, it's really re-energized me to recommit to this community and to this cause.
Thank you. So Lieutenant Governor, I want to go back to you. Your work speaks for itself in terms of the work you've done for paid family leave and the work that you've done with various women's issues throughout the state. And so I know you spoke about the work that you're doing to try to train women to get into office. And so I kind of speak for myself. So I follow you on Instagram, and you have this amazing New York Women's Lead, the project that where you're promoting women and the various, you know, achievements that they've made. So as a young woman, and I would say the last woman that served in my capacity on the CUNY board was in 2009. So my question to you is, what skills do you recommend for young women to develop in order to climb the ladder in their fields?
Great question. I would say no matter what your age is, you need to overcome fear of public speaking. If you want to champion and you want to be an advocate for people, I mean, we're all hardwired to just go through this death spiral every time we have to get in front of an audience. I mean, that's just natural. That's a human reaction. But even when I'm talking to the Future Farmers Association, if you're following me on Facebook, you know, it's just up there. And I'm telling these 10 and 12-year-old girls, you know, in your organization, get out there and speak. You get develop confidence. And because I would say there are institutional barriers. There are prejudices. There are biases. There's discrimination. That's all going to go on no matter what. But what you can change is not how you react to those circumstances, not how they impact you, but how you respond. And if you don't let this bother you, and if you want to break through, you have to have some confidence. And that is something I fully subscribe to, the concept of fake it till you make it. This has gotten me very far in life because I was quite shy until I was at Syracuse University. We got a lot of stories now. And I somehow turned into the student activist because I was trying to get our university as a student trustee to divest its holdings in companies with business in South Africa at a time we were trying to change policy with respect to the with respect to apartheid. And I got involved in a lot of initiatives, and I boycotted the bookstore because their prices were too high, and I had to take a couple incompletes, but I made up for it. I did graduate. So I was very much an activist coming out of high school as someone who had to work 35, 40 hours a week as a full-time high school student because we didn't have a lot of money, and I had to work at a pizzeria and make chicken wings. I'm from Buffalo. So I didn't get a chance to do girls' sports, which I think is the best way to nurture these skills, but I didn't have that available. I didn't do clubs because I was always working or babysitting younger families. So when I got to college, I was liberated, and I turned into a different person because of student government and feeling passionate about these issues. So fear of speaking holds people back, and I tell this, if you have an opportunity to speak, develop confidence, walk into rooms like you own them. It doesn't matter where you are, whether it's a boardroom, a classroom. When you have most of my life, I'm either in the vast minority or the only woman in a room. When I ran for town board, only woman. Only woman in county government. Only woman in the elevator 9 times out of 10 when I was a member of Congress. And we're surrounded by, and this is when the Tea Party dudes just got elected. They're all 6'5" and probably captain of the football team or basketball team. So I'm walking in there trying to connect with these people. And it can either intimidate you or just make you say, you know what, I'm going to win these folks over. I'm not going to let my gender, my height, whatever I got going against me in the world, I'm going to use that as a strength. And if you project confidence, you can go so far. And I think a lot of young women don't have that. I didn't have it as a young woman. I didn't even think I was qualified to run for town board, which is like an entry-level job. When I was 35, I had been counsel to Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan. I started family businesses. I had a family. I dealt a lot, and I still didn't think I could do what it took to run for town board. I was always going to be behind the scenes. Until a 22-year-old young man ran for that job, I said, I can beat that guy, okay? I got this guy. He's living at home with his mom and dad, just got out of college, and he thinks he can run for town board. You know, what's wrong with me? That's an example. I held myself back. And so I just had an intern the other day, a young man in my office, say, I'm going to run for office. I want to know where the 21-year-old girls are walking and saying, I'm going to run for office. Don't wait till you're middle-aged person like I was, have the confidence now. You have some. If you've got a heart, and I presume you're all doing a heart if you're sitting in this room, if you have a pulse, you have something to offer. You have something to offer. So don't hold yourself back, young ladies particularly, and women of all ages, because I did. So I would say develop public speaking, develop confidence, and develop that aura about you where you just walk in and nothing will stop you. That's what it takes to be a leader, and you can develop that even in high school.
Thank you. So, Secretary Rosado, I pose the same question to you. What advice do you have for young women who want to be as amazing as you are, to pursue their goals and climb up the ladder in their fields.
Well, I want to piggyback a little bit about on what Lieutenant Governor said. I think, you know, she's spot on in terms of confidence. But one way to get to confidence is also, and I'm, you know, really talking to the young women in the room also, is to know what you're talking about, right? To really study, you know, whatever the issue is that you're most passionate about, to do a deep dive. I mean, I think today we have a little bit, we have a superficial knowledge about everything as opposed to kind of a deep dive on one thing. And even as a journalist, that was kind of the most fun I had, was knowing a little bit about everything. I was a great dinner party guest because I could talk about anything. But what drove me to kind of focus on criminal justice, and now I'm involved in immigration, is to really take a deep dive. And when you have, you know, when you have that knowledge, when you read about that issue that you're passionate about, when you read the history of, you know, the suffrage movement that we're celebrating now, when you really know what you're talking about, that will go to your confidence, right? That you get up in front of a group of people and you can cover the, you know, the salient points on that issue that you're passionate about. And whether you're in an elevator or in a group full of, you know, a small group or a large group or in a room full of, you know, men or pink people, you're able to, you know, do that elevator speech. You're able to convince them. Like I would say, there was a time, you know, in my transition from being a newspaper publisher to my reentry to society, really was anyone who spent more than 5 minutes with me knew that I was passionate about reentry and how I was doing that. And, you know, and I tested it. I could do it in a minute and a half. And I think rehearsing that elevator speech, whatever your issue is a great way to get that confidence, so that when you have to get up and speak in front of people, you know, it's not intimidating. I'll tell you that when I was a publisher, I was on many transition teams. So I was on transition team for mayors and governors, and, you know, I was like transition king, which means, you know, you have to collect a lot of resumes and, you know, try to fill those. But I was sitting on a panel once. It was a criminal justice panel, and I had, you know, 32-year-old, this is in the Spitzer, when Spitzer became governor, and there were 32-year-old white guys who came in and said, you know, we were recruiting for the Medicaid Inspector General, was a position, I don't know if it still is, and these 32-year-old guys who have been with Spitzer in the Attorney General's office for a minute were like, I can do that job. And then I had, similarly, candidates of women or one African American male who had spent many years at Vera, who had like a 4-page resume, and they were so humble. They were just, you know, well, you know, I've been fortunate. They used that kind of vocabulary, and I was like, I'm gonna put up a business to help people go out there and sell themselves. And I think that goes to the confidence factor, that it's that this is not to, you know, criticize the 32-year-old white boys, is to learn from them, you know, is to say, wait, that's right. You know, if I spent a minute there, I can do that too. And so I think there was a study done about 4 years ago. It might have been Catalyst, but they said, you know, when women are looking for work, if they don't fill 100% of the qualifications, they don't apply. But men, if they fill 40%, they apply. And you know what happens when they apply? They get the job. And so I can't emphasize enough that I think, you know, confidence is the thing, and then how to get there, how to get that confidence is to really know your stuff and to put yourself in the positions, in the audiences, in the rooms, where you can actually inform others about that thing that is making you passionate.
It's funny, you and Secretary Cortez Vasquez, like, hit on the same, every time I speak to her, she's like, no, you can do this, you can do that. So I don't know if it's a secretary thing that you guys have going on there.
It's a Puerto Rican thing.
I can see. I didn't want to say it. So my question to you, I'm going to do just one more question for each of you, and then we'll accept some questions from the audience. So Christina, so we're over here talking about getting more women into the room as opposed to, you know, men who have dominated most of these rooms. But you work in a business that specifically is designed to service men, teaching them how to code. The tech industry
and more.
The tech industry is notoriously known to be male dominated. So what has been your biggest obstacle as a woman in tech, and can you briefly explain to us how you address it?
Sure. Well, It's hard. It's hard for a lot of reasons. One, All-Star Code is pioneering a holistic curriculum that, yes, mixes technical skills, coding, really thinking a lot about soft skills and mindset and attitude, as articulated in three pillars. Dare greatly, celebrate failure, and tell your story. And if we were to go back to advice, this would definitely be my advice to, well, everyone in this audience, especially for young women. Yes, tech is incredibly male-dominated. Startups are even more so male-dominated. Tech investors, even more so. These are the people who I'd really love to join my board and become donors. We've been very lucky to have support from AT&T and Goldman Sachs, other corporations with really robust philanthropy. Still struggling to get into the core of the tech world, and that does have to do, I feel, with being a Black and Asian woman, and just not having a lot of network with these people. There is no reason for, there's nothing in my background, my experience, and my credentials to suggest that I would be successful at doing what I'm doing. All I have is the fact that I am very successful at what I'm doing, and now I have 4 years to show it. We've doubled every year. So let's see, what advice would I have for other entrepreneurs? So, what the lieutenant governor said about considering running for office, I would say also consider starting your own organization or business. And I will qualify that and say there is something called intrapreneurship, where you are working for someone, and it could be for an institution like Hunter, but you are tasked with starting up some new thing within it. So it's very much entrepreneurial skills, but you don't have to be, you know, you can still like have a salary and benefits, et cetera. I would really recommend this to everyone. And you do not have to quit your job to do it. There's this concept of the side hustle. Has anyone heard of it? Yes! Great! It is, politics, by the way, is startup. You know, every campaign is a giant startup. And the skills, you know, whether you do go into politics or otherwise, there is so much opportunity now in the entrepreneurial realm in every industry, from the public policy sector to, you know, to business. That would really be my advice.
Thank you. So I'm going to now ask if anyone has questions, if you can just pass it to the end of your aisle so that we can collect it now. So if you guys can quietly, please, quickly, quiet and quickly write your questions and pass them to the end of your aisles. So I'm going to continue along. So Glennda, under the same theme of being a woman in a field that's maybe different, what struggles do you see that are specific in the LGBT community as a woman?
I would say that, you know, the LGBT community is an interesting one because it really, there's so much overlap and it's almost impossible to separate being a woman and being a lesbian. And in other ways, I have privilege that other people in our community don't have. You know, I am a white person. My gender expression matches my gender identity. And I see a lot of people in the LGBT community really struggling, and whether it's racism or sexism or transphobia, I think these things are all really connected, and I hope that one of the things we learned from this last election is that we're all in this together, and we need to care about each other and think about each other and really reach out and connect to each other. So I feel like one of the things that I do as a woman leader is try and put myself in other people's shoes and think about what it's like for them. And the more that we can do that, whatever shoes we happen to be wearing, the more successful we'll be as a city, as a country. And I think that's just something that we have to do a lot more of.
I can keep talking.
Thank you.
So, I'm just going to say, I think you're right. I think that women have empathy. And you hit on something that is something that really makes us hardwired to approach problems differently. I mean, the sense of putting yourself in someone else's shoes and how would they feel. I don't know that a whole lot of guys do that. You know, and I it's not natural. And I think that's why we excel in so many areas, especially in the side where we're talking about policies that help people and we can really understand what it's like to take care of a sick baby at home when you want to be there and not lose your job or an elderly parent. So I think, and what you do, and I just want to congratulate you. I remember last time I ran into you, the LGBT community had a spectacular rally to support the Muslim community in the face of the Muslim ban. And that's another example where communities that have been now out of the mainstream in a sense, who feel that they've been subjected to unfairness, reached out in a unconventional way and said, you know what, we're all in this together. And I really think there's a stronger sense of that post-election, whether you're fighting for LGBT rights or religious freedom and not people, ethnic freedom and gender freedom and whatever it is, there's a whole community of people who are not straight white males that have a lot of commonality. You know, no offense to the straight white males, because I love them, married to them, have kids. But when you think about the power of people that are not in that category, which really runs all of our institutions, I think there's a lot of power.
Yeah.
Thank you. So, our two audience questions that we're going to go with, the first one is going to be, if you are a confident woman, how do you navigate being seen as nasty, bossy, or abrasive? Do you alter your behavior with men, or do you just ignore it?
Can I answer? Because I am, I don't know why, compelled. Because I think I really was struck by what the Lieutenant Governor said about confidence, and I think every one of us sort of echoed that in some way. But what I will say personally has been something I've really had to get over as a woman leader to be successful, is to get over my fear of being criticized and to get over my fear, or my desire to be liked by everyone. And, you know, the LGBT community is not a monolith. We don't all agree. So even when I'm coming out saying something about the LGBT community, there are people who disagree, and they disagree loudly, and they know where to find me, and that's not just at the office, and I think that's true for a number of us. And I have really had to make a conscious decision to do what I believe is right, to get support for that, and then to stand up in the ring and be willing to be criticized, and to feel like being engaged in that is enough. And I have, it makes me have tremendous respect for the other women that do that, because it is not easy to stand up and sort of endure that. And I do think, you know, if we're sort of generalizing that there's research to say that men don't take that into account as much. I can tell you probably every criticism anyone's ever said about me from grade school on, and I've worked really hard, really hard to not let that hold me back and to keep going and to say this is evidence that I'm engaged, that I am a part of trying to make the world better, of trying to move things forward, and sometimes people are not going to agree with me, and that's okay.
I totally agree with that, and getting away from the fear about not being liked is something I've had to work on actually with managing my team now and finding that balance. So the gut answer to the question, you know, should you change, modulate, you know, do other stuff, is of course no. You got to be you. However, in the case of managing my employees, I really have had to think a lot about, and it's all kinds of things. It's kind of crazy. But in the thing of going out and, say, looking for funders and donors and others, I certainly do. And part of my job is to meet different people where they are. I'm always myself, but I do things differently. Now, but that said, you need to be you. You absolutely need to be you, especially if you're an entrepreneur, if you're or you're leading something. If it doesn't feel right, if you're constantly having to go up and speak and, you know, have the coaching or whatever and sort of modulating, and you then you're not going to look good on TV because you're not going to be relaxed. You're not going to be able to like join and be in the mix. So that's the word. And absolutely getting away from that and being willing to be criticized. And some meetings won't go well.
Thank you.
Because they won't.
So I think the short answer is I ignore it. I mostly always assume everybody loves me, and if they don't, it's like, if they don't, there's something wrong with them. But I want to make 2 points that I think are important. One is, I grew up in a male-filled, you know, newsroom. So it's always been, also been my experience that most of the people saying those things are women, and that we need to be more gentle with each other, because we often, you know, give the guys the vocabulary. They don't know Louboutins from, you know, whatever. They don't. We point it out to them. Right. And then secondly, that it's my belief, you know, at this point in my life especially, I've done a lot of training. And I think that what's most important in leadership is that if you're really a leader and if you're practicing leadership, then you have to be comfortable making people uncomfortable. Mm. And that means sometimes you're saying to someone, you know, something they don't want to hear, or, you know, you're being critical or you're being, you know, witchy. I think that I'm comfortable doing that because I consider myself a leader. I think it's my obligation, especially with sometimes surrounded with some of these, you know, young people running around the Capitol. And I feel entitled to, my experience gives me, you know, kind of, I feel entitled to be able to say to them, you know, I channel my inner Jennifer Raab and I say, you need to do that now. I think you mostly ignore it, but it takes time to get there because, of course, we all want to be liked. But I think more important than being liked is being remembered. And you know, whether people remember something you said or something you did, and you just, you know, if there are people who might be impervious to your charm, you need to move on.
Okay. So, Lieutenant Governor, just one last question so that we wrap up. So as I had mentioned before, the hashtag New York Women Lead, in this celebration of the centennial year, can you tell us what the Suffrage Commission is doing and how this can be used to generate activism among women?
Sure, I'd be happy to, but I want to answer that last question. I loved hearing how tough these women are and how resilient they are, and that's what I take strength from, is hearing other stories of women that are in the trenches and fearless and still put up with a lot. And, you know, in politics, you've got to have a thick skin. I mean, you really do, and I'll never forget when I was running for re-election for Congress and the Koch brothers and all these shady characters were spending millions of dollars to destroy my reputation, which was just taking a hit. The little girl next door told her mother, "Mommy, turn off the TV because they make Mrs. Hochul look so scary when she's on that broom." Of course, they had to do the witch ad. Yeah. That's me. So again, in all different ways, you know, we're taking our shots, and you have to be as tough as nails. And I roll by being what the conservative radio talk show host back in my district called me, an iron fist in a velvet glove. So I'll be nice. Okay, you'll think I'm really nice to a point. But you cross the line where you do something to hurt my people, you know, my seniors, my veterans, or my women, you know, whoever you're going after, I go for the jugular if I have to. And the governor and I just stepped out in a very forceful way against the Affordable Care Act repeal this past week. And we're out there getting our heads kicked in, and we're kicking back, and we're hitting. And I asked my staff how we're doing. It's like, you're doing fine. Just don't read the blogs. Don't read your Facebook. Don't read anything. And so you have to insulate yourself, too, because, don't read the blogs. But Women's Suffrage Commission, here's what we're doing. We have a spectacular group of people. It was created by law last year, and we launched a couple weeks ago. We're going to go around the state and tell the story, because in New York State, we own the history of women's rights. I mean, it happened in our state, the movement in 1848, the first convention up in Seneca Falls. And if you have not been there and you need some inspiration, walk those streets and think about what it was like to go to the outside of society and do what we do today. We gather in the streets, we protest, but guess what? No one's going to arrest us for voting. No one's going to take us down. No one's going to ostracize us the way women were back in that time. So the courage it took for them in that convention all the way up to 1917 when we finally got the right to vote, there are so many women that you need to know their stories and tell their stories to the young women of New York State. That is our legacy. And so we're going to be telling that story through TV ads, Empire State Development, and I Love New York. They're going to do some great ads this summer. We've got traveling programs around the state put on by parks. We've got great displays in our state capitol. We have a website we launched, which we're going to continue showcasing what is going on elsewhere in the state. So there's one place where you can go to find out all the events. And I personally will be continuing to have roundtables with women all over the state of New York, gathering them, all walks of life. I'm going to meet Girl Scouts in another hour. And we're going to talk about a Girl Scout patch that they can work to earn because they will have had to learn the steps of this early suffragette. So there's a lot we can do. We're open to ideas, but I'll leave you with this, is that I charge my task force with this. 100 years after 1917, we are looking back at the legacy and celebrating the courage and what those women accomplished. I ask the question, 100 years from now, when people look back at us, what will they say we did? What will we have done to better the lives of women and indeed all of society? And I feel that sense of weight on my shoulders because looking back is great, but I'm looking forward, and I feel that everyone in this room and everyone in our state has an obligation, a moral obligation, to make the conditions better for other people, because that's the reason we're here. So thank you very much for hosting. This is great.
If we can just give another big round of applause to our host, the Honorable Lieutenant Governor Kathy Hochul, and this amazing panel. Thank you all so much for joining us.